Hi, my name's Carl Rosenthal, and welcome to Migrating User Files and Settings. This is the next module in the Microsoft Virtual Academy course of migrating from Windows XP to Windows 8.1. As I said, my name's Carl Rosenthal. I'm a Microsoft Certified Trainer as well as a Microsoft MVP. We're just sort of further discussing the tools that are available to be able to make your process of doing that migration a little bit easier and a little bit simpler than what it would be otherwise. So today we're going to be looking at the main tool that we're using for this, which is going to be USMT. User state migration tool, and diving into that and some of the options that are available and how to use it, and with a little bit of a brief demo at the end of seeing some of the tools in action. In particular, the thing that you need to bear in mind with doing a migration from Windows XP across to Windows 8.1 is different versions, and you will need to use different versions in order for this to be able to function, as we'll discuss. So what is USMT? USMT, regardless of what version you're using, is a two-part process. There's two commands that you're going to see come up all the time. There's a process of scan state and load state. And essentially what scan state does is scan state gives us the ability to be able to capture our user settings and our application settings and our user data, and then load state gives us the ability to be able to push those settings and the application data back down onto a machine. So the two-part process is very important, and it is very separate from each other. So we do need to make sure that we're using the right tools for them. So USMT gives us the ability to be able to scale out very, very well the process of doing that capture and the deployment. And you know, kind of it's what I refer to as the fluffy kitten solution. And what I mean by that is that as administrators, what we care about when we put an operating system out onto a desktop is that the operating system works. What our users care about is the fact that their fluffy kitten background that they had previously in Windows XP is still the same fluffy kitten background that they now see under Windows 8.1. So that's about, that's essentially what USMT gives us the ability to do. Now, in a lot of organizations that I deal with, the need and requirement for this has lessened over the years as we've now started migrating from having being concentrated on local data to now having more data that lives on servers, and now moving into the cloud with redirected folders and that sort of thing. But it is, like, USMT still plays a really important part to ensure that we actually can capture data if we need to. So, as I said, USMT gives us the ability to be able to capture information, and it gives us the ability to do it for a couple of the different sort of environments that or different scenarios that we might have. So either refresh, and the refresh is if we're going from an existing OS, we are wiping the old OS, installing the new operating system, and then bringing everything back in. Okay, so this might be used for a cleanup purpose, or simply that you want to be able to install a full new version that might not be a new completely new version of the operating system, but maybe a bump with regards to an image that has all the updates already installed, that sort of thing. But we can use it to be able to make the transition in that purpose quite easy for the users. We also have the option to be able to replace a machine. Now, that's replacing a machine if we're going from a box that has, or going from, say, for instance, an old Windows XP machine to a new Windows 8.1 machine. The main wrinkle with that is that if we are doing that, we can't keep any of the data local. So we have to have the user data transmitted somewhere onto either a USB disk or alternatively into a network location. It is really important to consider what you are doing with the user data and where you're going to store that. If we are doing local, So say for instance, if it's the same box that we're moving from Windows XP to Windows 8.1, that's the same physical machine, then we might consider using something like the hard link migration. And we'll discuss that in the next module where that sort of comes in. But essentially it means that we keep all the data local. We don't have to copy it anywhere else. It's a very much faster way to be able to do our deployments. But if we're not, then we need to consider where we're putting this. And if we are putting this up onto a network location, we need to make sure that we have the time to be able to do the copy, we have the bandwidth to be able to do the copy, and more importantly, we have the storage available to be able to store however much data we're going to be capturing. And that might be something that you need to do, like test the waters with to start off with, as to how much information you might actually require. So what about an operating system requirement? What does USMT require? Well, USMT itself really doesn't have anything, okay? USMT has command lines to be able to run, and it's deployed as a X copy or a robocopy. We can deploy it out. We don't have to worry about the... we don't have to install the USMT as such. We just simply have to have the files available for it to run. We do need to have some temporary storage space in order for it to be able to pack up the information that it's then going to put into a network location. And we can use the slash P to be able to estimate how much information, how much data storage we're going to require in order for that process to take place. Okay. The USMT itself supports migrating from the same OS to the same OS or across to a newer OS. However, as we'll see, there's a slight wrinkle on that if we're going from Windows XP across to Windows 8.1. But certainly we can't go back to an older version. So we can't go, say for instance, you couldn't migrate from a Windows 8.1 across to Windows 7 using USMT. It's only sort of marching forward. The migration, the versions that we can migrate from, we can go from 32-bit to 32-bit, 32 to 64, or 64 to 64-bit versions of the operating system, but we can't go from 64 to 32-bit, and we can't go to any of the ARM or the Windows on ARM chip edition. So therefore, say for instance, you couldn't migrate from Windows XP machine across into onto Windows RT device as an example. There are ways that you can sort of work around that as such, if you need to, which would be putting all the data and that sort of thing into a SkyDrive, which is certainly available on Windows XP, and then that would then be available as, on the ARM device as well under Windows 8.1. It's just the ways to be able to get around some of the settings that you might put into place. And that's more for, as I said, for the user data, rather than the settings for the migrating to the ARM device. So further to that, we can't migrate between operating system languages. Okay. So therefore, we can't go from two different operating system languages. However, if we have the multiple user interfaces installed, then yes, that will certainly work. Also making sure that we've got all the right service packs and that sort of thing installed. When you go to run the scan state and the load state, you have to be a member of the local administrators group. Okay, otherwise it won't be able to pick up everything that we need to be able to gather. As well as that, we have to run it as part of an elevated command prompt. And the idea with this is that we have one user that creates the command. When they run the command, what they're doing is they're then going to be grabbing all of the data on the box, regardless of who the user is. So therefore, there might be 10 users who normally log into that machine, and if that's 10 users that log into that machine, then those 10 users will all be picked up by the process. And if we're using USMT, and we're going from USMT 5.0, which is the version that we're going to run across the Windows XP boxes, you can see that there's a whole bunch of applications that we're going to be able to pick up information from. Just one thing to note, that there is actually a hotfix that you require in order to be able to implement the Office 2013 support. But you can see, like, sort of, we cover across not just Microsoft applications, but also third-party applications as well, to be able to pick up the user data and settings from. And remembering that this is this is the list that we start with, but you can certainly add to that as you need to. So you can actually modify the XML files that we're going to be using to determine what we're going to pick up and what we're not going to pick up. You can actually modify those to be able to pick up more if need be. Or conversely, less as well, if you want to be able to filter out some of the information as well. So as I said, there's two commands that we're going to be primarily using. The two commands are scan state, and scan state is the one that we use to be able to do our pickup. Now, there's a couple of interesting commands that go along with here, and it isn't exactly the world's easiest command line to be able to put into place. Okay, and as well as that, I guarantee you, the first time that you start typing this out, you will get something wrong within it. It just happens. So, you know, when it happens, don't fret about it. Just accept it and move on. But the scan state, essentially the main things that we need to take into consideration are this. We need to make sure that we obviously type in the command. The location that we're going to be putting that to. Now, that can be either a network location, it can be a mapped drive, it could be a USB USB disk that we've got put into place. Or as we'll see, it could also be a hard link migration as well. But again, we'll look at that in the next module. We also need to look at the configuration that we're going to be putting into place. And that configuration is going to be using XML files, which then determine what applications we're migrating, what data we're what user information we're migrating, as well as what we're migrating with regards to the the general configuration of the box, so the settings, the users that we're pulling in. We can also adjust what level of logging that we're going to put into place, and that's the /V. And then also as to whether we're going to encrypt the file, whether we're going to compress the file. Now, by default, it does get compressed when we go to push it across to a network location. If we don't want to compress, we can use the /no compress, and that then turns that off. But we can also then filter with regards to the users that we're putting into place. So say, for instance, the /UEL as an example, then we can actually limit which users we put into place from, say, the users that haven't logged in since this particular date or haven't logged in for the last 30 days. So the idea being that, say, for instance, if you've got a box that you've been using for a couple of years, you may have a lot of information onto there for user data, for user profiles that just haven't been touched for a long time because you've had different users actually rotate through. So we can use scan state to be able to filter out what information we're going to be able to, or what information we pick up. So we're not picking up a bunch of old profiles that have never been used or that haven't been used in a long time. So the flip side of scan state, which does our capture, is then load state. And load state then gives us the ability to be able to load the information down. You'll see that the commands are very similar between scan state and load state. A couple of ones that are different that you might use to be able to do some modifications with are the MD and MU. Now, what they give us the ability to do is they give us the ability to be able to modify the domain settings as we go down. So say, for instance, if we're modifying with, you know, as part of our process of migrating from one operating system across to another, we might also be replacing the domain because the machine, if the users are being incorporated into a new domain, then we can take the old domain name, so say, for instance, woodgrove.com, and turn that into contoso.com. So therefore, when we go to do our migration, the load state will be able to intelligently change the domains across. And whenever it sees woodgrove.com, it'll now be contoso.com. And also with the MU, that gives us the ability to migrate the username. So say, for instance, in different methodologies that we might have, like say in the old domain, my name, my username might be Kyle R, whereas in the new one, it's we're going for having the initial and last name, so it'll be now K Rosenthal. So therefore, as part of the migration, not only am I changing the domain, but I can also change the user ID as well, so that then when I get picked up into the new domain, obviously the profiles and that sort of thing will actually match up then. So it's a nice easy way for an administrator to be able to make some fairly hefty changes, but just simply being able to script it through. So USMT, so using USMT to move from XP across to Windows 8.1, there is a challenge to it. Okay, so USMT 5.0, which is the not the latest version, but it's the second to latest version, can scan across XP machines, but we can't. So we can use scan state on that, but we can't use load state from that on Windows 8.1. 6.3, which is the latest version, can't scan XP machines, but can, so can't run scan state on the XP machines, but we can run load state, run load state on Windows 8.1 using USMT 5.0 files. So how do we solve this problem? How do we get around it? Well, it's a two-part process, and it's always a two-part process anyway, but we just need to make sure that we're using the right versions to be able to do the right process at the right time. So if we're for our capture from Windows XP, use USMT 5.0 to be able to do our capture, and then we use load state to be able to do the next process, and the load state being the next process being the using USMT 6.3 to be able to push that out onto the Windows 8.1 environment. The other thing to bear in mind within all this is that USMT is useful once we actually have put into place the process of our deployment of the operating system and the applications. Okay, so we'll discuss that some more shortly. In the meantime, though, let's just have a look at what USMT looks like. Okay, so let's now have a look to see what the USMT command looks like when it's actually being run. Now, first off, the machine that I'm using on here, I am looking at a Windows 8.1 machine. The command is exactly the same as if it's a Windows 8 or 8.1 or a Windows XP machine, so it makes no difference. The only thing that you need to keep in mind, as we said before, is just make sure you bear in mind the version that you're using. So remember, we've got a different version to be able to do the scan state from Windows XP to the version that we're going to when we do the load state on a Windows 8.1 machine. But apart from that, it's exactly the same command that we're going to be using. So the it's just simply the version that we actually use. Okay, so the other thing with USMT, as we said, is that it is just simply the files that we require. It's designed to be able to be deployed by using just simply an xcopy or robocopy or something similar to that. So therefore, there's no requirement for us to actually go and install it on a machine. What I've done onto here is I've just simply made a copy of the files into just a folder called USMT on the local machine. And if you have a look into there, the default settings that are in there come across in things like, say, for instance, the, if we sort this into an easier way to be able to find the information, we've got our load states and our scan state. Now, those two files, the load state and scan state, are just simply the files, that's the executable files that we run. And then our XML files, the basic ones that are included, the migapp, migdocs, miguser. And now the default ones that are in there will do a default capture. What we can do is we can then go and edit these as we like to be able to define further what we want to be able to capture, and also to be able to get rid of things that we don't want to capture. And it's just simply a matter of removing them from within here from the MIG user to be able to stop us from picking up things like, say, for instance, the my video files or something along those lines, or the my music files. Instead, we can actually effectively get rid of those and not capture the information. Remembering that with USMT, it's a matter of balancing what we are going to grab and what we're not going to grab. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a run up an administrative command prompt, Under Windows 8.1, don't forget the easiest way to do that is just simply using the Windows key X, and that gives you then the command line, or gives the option to be able to pull up an admin command prompt, which is what we've got here. And always remember to run this as an administrator, and the reason you're running it as an administrator is just simply so that it has permissions to be able to get to all the files that are on the local machine, because you want to be able to get to all of the user accounts that are local to be able to pull those up. Okay, so what we're going to do to start off with is we're going to run the scan state command. And with scan state, the first thing that we want to do is we want to create a configuration file for this local machine. And the way that we do that is we run a command called scan state / gen config. And what that does is it creates a generic configuration file for this particular machine. Okay. Now what that does is we'll see it'll actually go through and it'll look at the different user accounts that are in here. We'll see in the background that it'll create a new XML file. Once it's completed, and depending on how many users you have will obviously depend on how long this will take for it to actually complete running. But then what we'll see is in the back end here we have a config file. Now if we open this one up, you'll see that config file is then all of the configuration file. It's a configuration file based off what's actually contained within this local box and what we want, or what we might want to be able to capture and pull up on the local machine. So we can go into here and we can make changes, essentially any of the things that say migrate yes if we don't want to pull those up. So say for instance we don't want to pull up gadgets, we don't want to migrate the gadget settings, then I can edit that to say no, and then that means it won't actually pull that information out. And we can scroll down, you can see there's a whole heap of things that it's actually created. You can add to that as you need to as well, to be able to make sure that we've got some further information that we're putting into place. We can add in things like adding in domain mapping. So domain mapping from one domain across to another domain, user across to another user, to be able to make it nice and simple to be able to run the configuration command. If you don't, with those sort of things, if you don't run it within the config.xml, don't forget we can still run that from within load state anyway when we go to be able to do the load state to do that translation. Okay. So once we've actually created the configuration file, we can then go and, as I said, edit that as we please. Now what I've done is I've mapped a drive, and I generally would map a drive as part of my script if I was running this, across into where my store is going to be if I'm using the scan state into a store. In this case it's going across into my iDrive. So I'm then going to type in the command to be able to get that up and running. So typing in the command, the scan state command, going to be going onto my iDrive, as I said, which I've got mapped, and pulling up the MIG app, the MIG docs. I could also pull in the MIG user settings, etc., by using the same settings into there. And I'm going to pull in that config.xml file. The slash o that I put into there is just simply overwrite, so if there is currently anything in that folder for this particular machine, I can then use it to overwrite. And under normal circumstances, I probably wouldn't use no compress. What I'd probably use in a corporate environment is I would type in encrypt, and then I'd have to put in a key for that. Okay. And the idea being that they didn't have a secure key to be able to put into place. Now, in my case within here, I'm not going to do that. And the reason for that is just simply that I want to be able to see what these files look like, so we can actually see what gets captured after we've done the command. The other thing you might want to do from a troubleshooting perspective is to put in for the logging, so that it actually does a higher level of logging. And that's just using -v5 into there. So what that does is that then starts to do the log file. There's also another command that I can put into there. I could put into have a progress path as well, so I could then see what it's actually doing. But it kind of gives us a fairly good sort of set of updates as it's going through within here. Now, obviously, depending on what we're capturing, depending on how much information we've got, will depend on how long this will take to be able to progress through. So what we're going to do is leave that go, and we'll return once it's actually completed, which shouldn't be too long, but I don't want to keep you waiting while we're actually watching it go. Okay, so now we've completed the run of the USMT. Now there's a message that's come up, which is nothing to really worry about, but just a note to take to something to take note of, that there was a migration error that would have been fatal if not for the slash C. Now the slash C essentially says ignore any of the any issues that might occur, and keep going anyway. And it tells you to look at the log file. And the log file to look at is the scan state log file, which is in the same folder that you actually run this from. And so what I did was I actually like amongst the pausing and of the video and the re-recording it for full disclosure, I actually reran the command with the slash C command on it, so that it would then work. Now basically what it did was it stopped it from dumping out at this level, okay, which was just simply the Windows Defender scan history. Now because the file was already in use, it couldn't take a copy of it. So if we didn't have the slash C, what it does is it actually dumps out, and it gives you a bit of an odd error. It gives you an error. It's a cancel due to an IO error. So if you ever see that, just rerun the command with the slash C and you should be right. Now what that does for us is that then creates the folder over on our shared folder. And if I go into my migration that I created, so that was the one PC1, because that was the name of the folder I put it into, you'll see there's a catalog file, and the catalog file essentially holds all the details about what it captured, as well as a file holding all of the actual data that's been captured. Now, because I said no compress, this is showing as just as a browsable file and folder structure. If I had put it on, if I hadn't done slash no compress, what it would do is it would actually show it as being a .mig file. So therefore, it's a little bit more secure. And if I've done the slash encrypt, then obviously that would be even more secure. So the idea is that once we've got our scan state, we can then reverse the process. And reversing the process is pretty easy. Reversing the process is a matter of using the load state command to be able to load using the configuration file that we've got. So the configuration files of the MIG app, the MIG user, and as well as at the config XML files, to be able to then pull the information back down again. And essentially, it's the same command line that we'd use to be able to do that. And so what I'd run is I'd run the load state, and again, I'd have to have the right bits available, so depending on where I'm running it from. And then, in this case, my mapped drive across to my PC1 folder, which is where I've got the information into. That's where it's actually stored. And then, obviously, the MIG app and the MIG... MIG docs file and any of the other inputs that I've got put into place. So, and as we discussed during the presentation, any of the filters that we might put in as well. So, and again, putting in the information for our logging. Okay, and then if we had encrypted to start off with, then at this point we'd have to put in the decrypt, as well as then the key. whatever that key might be. If you don't have it, it didn't do the decryption or didn't encrypt it to start off with, then we just simply type in the command as such. And we'd run that, obviously we'd run that on the new machine to be able to pull the information back down, pull the settings back down again, at which point we then have all the settings put into place. Bear in mind, remember that you have to have first off installed all the applications that you're pulling the settings back down onto. So that's USMT, a quick demonstration of what the command line actually looks like. So that was USMT in process. So the summary of that, we've had a look to see what it actually looks like. We've had a look to see how the USMT works, and also the challenge with using Windows XP to Windows 8.1 migration. Okay, so remembering that what we need to do is we need to make sure that we do the capture under Windows XP using USMT 5.0. So using scan state from within there. We then store that away somewhere. We then take we deploy our operating system, we install all of our applications, and then what we do is we pull over the top of that the settings and the user data using the load state from USMT 6.3. Okay, so that, once you've got that in place, the rest of it's all gravy. Okay, so some useful links for you. The USMT 5.0, the download for that, as well as USMT 6.3. And remembering that these are part of the Windows ADK, so you need to just make sure you get the right version of the ADK. And then also a link of how to migrate from Windows XP to Windows 8.1 using System Center 2012 R2 Configuration Manager. Now we'll touch on Configuration Manager a little bit more later on. But what this does is gives you some pointers on using the tools to be able to do that process, and essentially putting all the things that we've been talking about into one distinct process. So remembering that this is part of the course from the Microsoft Virtual Academy, and make sure you join us for the other modules that are in the course, and also make sure that you have a look to see if there's any other useful courses that you might want to complete across the Microsoft Virtual Academy. They're all free. They're available for you at any time as an on-demand sort of process. As well as the IT camps, so making sure that you actually look at the see if there's any IT camps that are going to be available near you. There's new topics coming out for that all the time, and there's new IT camps that are being booked and made available for you all the time. And in addition, if you do need to test anything that we've been doing over the period of this course, then make sure you do grab the eval product from the TechNet Eval Center, as well as that on TechNet there is some virtual labs as well to be able to complete, and on the topic of migrating from XP to Windows to Windows 8.1, there are some more labs that will be added in as we progress through, and you'll be able to certainly test though use the virtual labs to be able to play around with the various different products that we certainly talk about from within here. So that brings us to the conclusion of this module. Please make sure that you do join us for the remaining modules as well. Particularly the next one, we're going to be diving in a little bit more into USMT, and in particular looking at hard link migration and how that might assist to be able to speed up the process of doing your migration from Windows XP to Windows 8.1 by keeping everything local on the machine. So my name's been Kyle Rosenthal, and I'll see you on the next course.